Dr. Percival. Thank you for coming.
Doctor's here, Mama. I've seen him.
Lord save us. He ain't to the house, is he?
No, ma'am. He's headed towards Calmia.
Well, he might could be here any time. Was it just now you seen him?
Yes, Mama. You reckon he's headed towards the Griggs?
Yes. Yes, I do.
Mama, you want me to run out and tell Bobby?
No, I don't want no such thing. Run out back. Tell your daddy.
Coming. Mama said tell you.
He ain't here, is he?
No, he's headed towards Greg's. Mike could be here any time.
Well, don't get everybody all stirred up.
Mama said not to tell Bobby.
Maybe his leg has caused him to go deaf and he ain't heard you yet.
Does he know you?
Sometimes.
Yes.
I'm afraid they grow less frequent.
He always had the constitution of an ox.
He hated sickness.
He's beyond my or any man's practice. What about that boy in the village?
Did you want to see him tonight?
Your note said it was urgent.
That is what was relayed to me, but I haven't seen the boy myself.
Then I'll not stay on the order of my going.
Let me get my things. Mr. McAvoy, this is Dr. Percival.
Lord, Mrs. Gregg. You ought not to have come. I mean, what with the trouble in your own house? Martha, put the kettle on.
Please don't trouble yourself, Mrs. McAvoy. I only came to see about the boy.
Well, we sure do appreciate that.
Where is the boy?
I'll show him, Mama.
Let me take your coat, Miss Gray.
Thank you.
Just get your chair. It's a good girl.
Is this all of your family, Mrs. McAvoy?
Yes, ma'am.
What is your name?
Mary Ellen.
Yes. And Martha?
Yes, ma'am.
Please don't bother with anything, Mrs. McAvoy.
I sure do appreciate this, Miss Gray. That boy,
I don't know. Ain't gonna be no easy patient.
May I have a glass of water, please?
Big sister, get the doctor a glass of water. Well, might it not mend?
I'm sorry, McAvoy.
Is the operation unavoidable, doctor?
If he's to live. Badly in sepsis, madam. Badly.
Yes.
It might could mend.
Mrs. McAvoy, it could not mend. Not in this world.
I don't see how you can know that for certain.
Mrs. McAvoy, when I take my thumb and press it into the flesh of that boy's leg and then remove it, and the shape of my thumb remains like a thumbprint in bread dough, then I know that that flesh is dead, deceased, not even the bones escaped, and the tainted part corrupts the well until the body is corrupted throughout. Sorry to be so plain-spoken. I can assure you that radical removal of the affected part is the only hope.
And the boy, how will you?
I'm afraid there's nothing for it. Once my man has administered the chloroform.
Where is he?
Mrs. Gregg, I don't think he'll listen. He swore at me.
He'll not at me. Martha, show me your brother's room. What Dr. Percival says is true. You must have the operation.
I'd rather to be dead.
No one has the right to say that. Life is a precious gift from God.
It's up to him. God put the rod in it, didn't let it rot off.
You don't know what you say. Think of your family. I lost a son in the war. I know what it is. I'd have wanted him back with no legs. God doesn't ask that all the flowers in his garden be perfect. And I think he has a special love for the ones that are...
Ones that are crippled.
It's been over a week since you fell. You know it's not mended. Have you looked at it?
Looked at what?
Your leg. Have you seen it?
No, I ain't seen what I want to see it for.
Let me see it.
No.
Why not?
You can't see it. It's wrapped up.
That's a lie. Let me see it.
No!
I'll stay with you. Doctor, I think you may fetch in your assistant now.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Did you want to be driven home?
No, I'll stay. I promised the boy. Perhaps Martha would help you with your things. Martha, would you like to help the doctor?
Perfectly all right. Willis and I can manage.
Doctor, you don't anticipate any complications.
We have every confidence of success, ma'am. In the late war, I removed over 1,000 limbs. I was called in on the most difficult cases.
Friends and neighbors, we're gathered together here today at a most solemn and sad occasion. The man whose earthly remains lie here, and whose spirit we commend to a just God, has been a guiding force in the lives of nearly every one of us. William Gregg was all his life an example of the virtue of hard work. There are many of us here today who can remember what life held in the way of promise. before this band came among us. Too many of us were raised in hunger and poverty to ever forget. To see what he has wrought, the neat homes, the churches and the schools, the gardens and the lovely grounds. But last but not least, the massive factory structure with its beautiful and perfect machinery, which shall continue to bear fruit for generations after the first laborer himself has passed away.
I reckon you're the boy. McAvoy. That it?
That's it.
That's it? Did they not learn you to sir at your home?
Sir.
If Mr. Gregg was to hear that, he'd flop over in his grave like a fish. God rest his soul. Good manners were never out of place, he always said. Tell you what, you can start in by cleaning this here place up, son. Right through yonder and on the right is the closet with the broom in it, if I'm not bad mistaken. We'd best get the heaviest dirt out before Cotton starts to volunteer in here. Can't you? I mean, you can manage a broom all right, can't you? I hadn't thought about.
I could do anything anybody else can.
I don't care what they told you. We're not taking on any more hands.
Well, they done paid our fare down here on the train to go to work.
You mean your friends and neighbors did? Took up a contribution?
Yes, sir.
Well, they'll not take up a purse to get you back, though, will they?
I don't know.
Well, I do.
We never allowed we'd be going back. They said we could come down here and go to work. Put the young'uns to work. And the girls. Said we'd get a sealed house and a garden patch.
How many of you are there?
Well, now there's at least a dozen hands. There ain't but two of them young'uns under 12 year old. Some of them slot for their age, but I guarantee them to turn in a day's work.
How many fares?
Fares?
We have to know how many half fares and how many whole.
We've paid our fares come down here.
How many of you all together?
There's 18 of us come down.
All in one family?
Lord God, no, not in no one family.
Find out how many fares are there and make arrangements for tickets back wherever the hell they come from.
It's a damn outrage, Captain Gray.
Well, what would you do with them?
I know, but it's still a damn outrage.
Well, send on up to the church and see if we can get them some supper.
We ain't even had no breakfast yet.
Get them out of here on the afternoon train.
Captain, you sure you ain't got no place for us? We come a long ways to be turned back. I mean, they showed us the Dodger, said to come on.
The last bill we put out was 4 years ago. Mr. Giles?
Mrs. Cornish will go crazy when she sees this lot. She said after the last time she wouldn't put up with any more of it.
Well, that's what she said all other times. Tell her some of God's seed has fallen on barren ground.
Yes, sir. Let's go.
What we're about to receive, Lord, make us truly thankful. Amen.
I hope you ain't praying for Bobby to get to supper this evening. You vex the Lord.
I was just praying.
Martha, darling, would you be so good as to pass the meat before the flies blow it? Crazy in the woods like a wild Indian.
Is he still going to work of a morning?
Mm. They tell me. I don't understand that boy. I don't understand nothing about him. Some of the things he says. I mean, they make sense, but they sound, I don't know what all goes on in his head.
What things he says?
Things that he says.
Like what?
Like here a few evenings ago, little sister popped up and she said, I wish we lived in a better house. And Bobby just looked at her and he said, that wouldn't make you no better than what you are. I just don't know what to make of him.
When are we going back to our other house, Daddy?
Why, Mary Ellen, what in the world?
Hush, eat your supper, will you? There ain't no other house.
Bobby says we used to have a cow.
It was like pulling teeth to get him to milk it.
Bobby says there's caves all in under Graniteville where engines has been.
Maybe he's took to living down there in them. Him and the heathen can rage together.
Bobby's not no heathen.
I never said he was, Mama. He just got kindly infidel ways, you know.
What's infidel ways?
Bobby is not no infidel.
What's a heathen?
It's a person that don't go to church.
Is Bobby a heathen, Daddy?
No. Eat your supper. Yeah. He's not no heathen. He just got a troubled heart. And they don't nobody know why.
I didn't know the time could go so slowly, like a child's summer.
How come nobody ever knew that boy's name?
I don't know. We were in Charleston.
You reckon he intended coming here?
To the mill, you mean? I don't know. He got sick, they took him off the train here. I don't know where he was bound. Must have had relatives somewhere. People who waited for him to arrive. He never arrived. Hard to know what God would mean by such a thing. Seems a hard way to tell us to love one another.
He probably run off from somewhere.
The boy is dead, James. He was just a child.
He's been dead for 20 years. And people say it was the war. But it was the same before the war. People wandering up and down the country, eat up with hookworm, God knows what else.
James.
Inbred, their eyes grown together.
James.
Come down here, expect us to put them to work. Raise the children up in habits of industry.
Isn't that just a little too easy, James? Considering the advantages you've had.
No, I don't think so. These people think we're running a doss house down here. You don't have to put up with it.
These people?
The world is made up of indigence and diligence. You can't help the indigent. The more you do for him, the weaker he gets. The diligent don't need your help. They'll say the good Lord must have loved the poor because he made so many of them. I think he just kept trying to see if one of the squint-eyed sons of bitches wouldn't get off his ass and do some work.
I don't have to listen to that sort of language and consecrate a ground.
I apologize. And I apologize to all of the good people in the ground up here.
I'll walk home.
Mother? Come on. That I can't stand this sort of sentimentality. We had a family of these hill people down here a couple of weeks ago. Didn't have a pot to piss in or a window to throw it out of, excuse me, but it is the truth. And they worked for about 2 weeks, and then they left. And you know what they said? They said they didn't like the water. Habits of industry. Good God.
James. Your father put a good deal of store in the common people. They made this company. He believed that this place could be a garden. A garden of industry. Where people only needed the opportunity to work.
I know what he believed. It's all right. Can I help you?
I was hunting my brother.
Your brother?
Yes, sir.
Come on in. I mean, I don't have him, but we can talk about it.
Well, if he ain't here.
Come on in. I won't bite. Not hard, anyway. Where they keep you here at? I don't recall seeing you before.
I just work in the spinning room.
And what is your name?
Martha.
Well, Martha. How old are you?
14.
14? You got a boyfriend?
No, sir.
Don't have a boyfriend?
No, sir.
Well, I don't know why not. Maybe you're just too feisty for these young boys.
I ain't feisty.
I don't know about that. I bet you'd just be a handful.
Handful of what?
Well, I'd be afraid to say. You don't smoke cigars, do you?
Do what?
Smoke cigars. Are you a cigar smoker?
No.
Oh.
But I'll take one to my daddy if you're passing him out.
Well. Yes, sir, Miss Martha. I do believe that you would be a handful.
I don't know nothing about that.
You don't know nothing about that?
No.
Well, I'll tell you what. I'll tell you what, Miss Martha. I'll bet that you do know something. would you like to have that? Wait a minute!
Captain Giles.
Morning. You got a good warm place to work in.
Yeah, when the sun shines.
I just stopped by on the way to the house. Wanted to ask you about Bobby. Has he quit his job?
He is.
Well, I just wanted to tell you we're going to have to take on a new boy.
If you do, you do.
You know, he's not supposed to stay on at Company House, old as he is, unless he's employed by the company. I mean, it's company policy.
Yes, sir.
Well, what he wants. Nobody gonna put a gun to his head and make him work. But them that choose not to toil, neither do they spin, they've got to birth elsewhere.
You don't need to bother yourself none about Bobby.
There's sure been some of a bother to us.
Said you don't need to bother yourself none about him.
Why not?
He's gone.
Where'd he go?
He never said.
Dear Bobby, I wrote you once, but I never heard from you, so I will try this new place. Mama has took sick again. She just can't seem to do no good. I wish you could come home. Mary Ellen is big now. You wouldn't hardly know her. Daddy is fine. He says for you to come home. I am working. Your sister, Martha.
Thank you. What are y'all doing up here?
We digging a grave. I don't like to eat my dad out there. He don't care, but I do.
But them folks in there don't care. No more than you would.
Everybody ain't got the sense to on me that don't care. Getting this life out of it. You new in these parts?
This grave you digging?
Some old woman that died.
Some lady died in town. Don't know her name. She ain't got no folks buried up here.
Her husband gave us $2. Are we supposed to get paid for Mr. Evans? But he says not to take his money, and he give us the $2.
You don't know her name?
No, sir.
He was up here most of the morning. Went all around taking up the old dead flowers off folks' grave. Said folks ought not to bring flowers if they wasn't fissing to come back.
Oh, you shouldn't be.
Y'all eat your dinner and get back on down to wherever you started from. That woman's not to be buried up here. She don't belong to the mill.
We got to work to suit the man what pays us. She don't want that grave dug, you see him.
Oh, you sure do.
You get your shit and get gone. I see you up here again digging, I'll blow a hole in your black ass.
Yes, sir. That'd be all right. We was just talking about that. You come up.
Oh, yeah, well, you hush. You quiet now. I know when I see you. You was nothing but trouble.
Where's the old man?
Where's Martha? Y'all get out. I don't know you.
We can't leave. We give word to set up with her.
I want you out. Get out.
When did she die?
Yesterday, early in the morning. You got the letter? I know you come quick as you could.
Wish you hated this place like I do. No, I don't. She's supposed to get took back up home.
It's all right.
No, it ain't.
It's done been arranged, Bobby. For her here.
She ain't gonna be buried here.
What you aim to do?
He's got enough money, he could have took her back up there on the train.
He can't stand it, Bobby. He just tore up.
Where's he at?
We went up there last year, me and Mama. We seen our old place up at Pickens, and then we went to Greenville, and I seen Captain Bobby. He was harnessed to a wagon in the street, and he knowed me. We was up there 3 days.
Where's he at?
I don't know. I sent Mary Ellen up to Claybo's. He wouldn't have her buried today. He said, give Aunt Fern and them time to come up here. I prayed every day for you to get my letter. From the time she first took sick.
Trouble finds a house and stays on. You can't get shit of it.
Don't be that way, Bobby.
Oh, what way am I? You don't know how I am. You don't know me.
You're still my brother.
Good book says all men are brothers. It don't seem to cut no ice, does it?
Thank you.
Who's that? Who's there?
Oh, it's you.
I was looking for my father.
Well, you'll not find him here.
Where would I find him?
We got to keep these boys out of here. They broke some more of these lights. You see them there lights? Busted them out.
What's it used for?
How's that?
What's it used for? The greenhouse. There ain't nothing growing in here.
Well, don't have to be used. Ain't no sign to tear something up just because it ain't used no more. Rock it plumb out. You see that? Just because a thing ain't used, ain't no sign to rock it to death.
I was looking for my father. He's a gardener.
I know who he is. But he ain't the gardener. No more he ain't. You see any gardens?
No.
Garden's not big here no more.
Well, where do you reckon I might find him at?
Always knowed him for a sober man. Day's work done, why would he not be home?
Well, he ain't there.
Back years ago, of a winter's day, when it was sunshiny, used to come out here at dinner time, take my dinner. It'd be warm in here. The least bit of sun, it'd be warm. And you could smell stuff growing. Your daddy'd come by sometimes, see me in here. Just go on by, never would say nothing. Past fall here, one evening I was making my rounds and I thought I seen a light down here. I come in and held my lantern up, pass at your pappy. He was just sitting there in the dark, smoking his pipe. I asked him if he was all right. He said yes. Said he just wanted to get out of the house for a while.
I gotta get on.
You done right, come in here. Trouble will cause people to hunt out places where they saw better times.
Well, look here.
I thought you'd quit these parts, young buddy.
My mama died.
I didn't know that, honey. Why don't you sit there and get you a drink? I'm sorry to hear that.
I thought maybe the old man might have come up here.
Pat?
Get your chair there. Come on over and warm.
Yeah, come on up now.
No need to be a stranger.
Well, I just raised it again.
Okay, but you don't start off with all of that. Try this here, a little old eight.
Give that man a drink of whiskey, Ed.
What all she died of?
Malaria fever.
When did she die, honey?
Yesterday morning.
Well, at least you got here for the burying. They ain't buried her yet, have they?
Ed, give us a little of that mule shoe here.
Oh, you won't wait a minute. I'm playing in this game.
Here, honey, get you a drink. You all's almost growed, ain't you? I mean, ain't no babies at home.
Mary Ellen's the least in.
Well, it's hard when they leave youngins. Man can't raise them.
Yeah, you tell your daddy we're just as sorry as we can be.
Finer son of a bitch never wore shoe leather. Ed, you think we could have another little drink here?
You back to stay, are you?
I don't know.
Reckon you've seen right smart of the world since you went out of here, huh?
Son.
Time is kind of slack around here. I expect the air's everywhere.
You reckon you're gonna get on down at the mill?
I ain't lost nothing down there.
Well, I hear you. Don't you know that the only way a man can get ahead down at the mill is get his wife knocked up by the boss? Well, get himself a little leverage.
I'd best get on, Hunt, old man.
Talk about people dying. Well, you talk about people dying, I hear they found another old boy dead in the woods down near Vaucluse. We speculate the niggers got him. Had his throat cut, they said.
Where'd that jug get to?
Yeah, Ed, how about that? Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord, how they hate whiskey down to that mill.
They hate for you to drink it. Of course, and that don't mean they won't take a little drink themselves.
The old man would, by God, not take one.
You're right about that.
Guarantee goddamn to you.
What about James?
That son of a bitch will take a drink. Never thought I'd live to see the day. Niggas running crazy, killing people. Right here in your own county. Don't get him started on the niggers, please, God.
Thing about James, he don't believe in putting a jam on the lower shelf. The little man can get some.
Get you another drink there, house cat.
There's plenty of rhubarb all around the farm, and another little drink won't do us any harm.
Well, I've got to do all I could do. Oh, wait on that. Yeah, you got it this time, but you won't get it next time.
for you to come in today. You know your son's back?
I heard he was. I ain't seen him.
He was up to the cemetery yesterday, where they're fixing your missus' resting place. Come up there and he went and run the niggers off with a pistol and told them there wasn't a Mary's mama there. I just wanted you to know. I wish you'd talk with the boy, see him before he gets himself in trouble.
I don't know where to hunt him at. He came up the house, they said. Run everybody off up there. I don't know what to tell you.
That boy of yours swore he won't never go set foot in this here mill no more.
He did.
We just went down there.
Thank you. Do you want to see me?
I was looking for my father.
Your father?
He was a gardener.
I know who he was.
No, you don't.
What do you mean, I don't?
You might know his name is all. Where are you going working at?
He works in the mill. This company is in the textile business. We have stockholders to answer to. We're not in the flour business.
Shit.
What did you say?
You heard me.
What do you want, McAvoy?
I don't want a goddamn thing from you.
You'd better clear out. We don't need your kind around here.
What do you mean, my kind?
You'd better leave.
What do you mean, my kind?
People who don't want to work. You had your chance here.
Who's his ass?
Why did Mr. Giles let you go?
Mr. Giles did not let me go. I left my own goddamn self, and if he says different, then he's a liar.
My recollection is that you were turned off for stealing.
That's a damn lie.
You'd better get out, McAvoy.
I ain't done yet. You think that you can say anything you want to people and they just have to put up with it?
I think you're crazy. That's what I think. What are you doing here? What do you want in my office?
You think the people in this town don't know what you are?
By God, I do believe you came in here looking for something to steal.
You're a goddamn liar.
You call me a liar?
I didn't stutter.
What do you want? Money? Take that and get out.
Don't.
You raggedy-ass, crippled son of a bitch!
Good God! Captain Grant!
That Robert McAvoy, not having the fear of God before his eyes, but being moved and seduced by the instigation of the devil, on the 20th day of April in the year of our Lord, 1876, with a force of arms at Graniteville in the county and state aforesaid, in and upon one James J. Gregg, in the peace of God and of this state, then and there being, did make an assault, and that he, the said Robert McAvoy, a certain pistol of the value of $5, then and there, load with gunpowder and divers leaden balls, then and there, feloniously, willfully, and of his malice aforethought, did strike, penetrate, and wound, giving unto the said James J. Gregg, then and there, with the laden balls, as aforesaid, sent forth out of the pistol aforesaid, divers mortal wounds of the depths of 6 inches and the breadth of 2 inches each, of which said mortal wounds, he, the said James J. Gregg, from the 20th day of April, in the year 1876, until the 21st of April, in the last year aforesaid, at Augusta, in the county of Richmond, in the state of Georgia, did languish, and languishing did die.
I believe he must have fired the shot from across the desk. I saw Captain Gregg rise, and McAvoy turned and ran out the door. And Captain Gregg followed him through the office, and then there was another shot from outside. And when I got to the door, Captain Gregg had collapsed.
Captain Giles, did you see a pistol in Captain Gregg's hand when you first saw him in his office?
No, sir, I did not. I don't know that Captain Gregg was in the habit of going armed.
Then I asked him if he meant his statement of the shooting to be a dying declaration, and he said yes, he said he did. He said he had 2 policies of life insurance, and he wanted to show that he hadn't caused the difficulty. I was present on the train when his declaration was read back to him. He was in pain, very weak, but he was able to sign it under oath.
Chin up, McAvoy. Chin up. The boy has every confidence in us, and we expect you to feel the same.
They're trying to hang me.
Tut, tut, McAvoy. Far from being hanged, we have every expectation of getting him all scot-free.
I don't see why Bobby can't testify for himself.
Worst mistake in the world, McAvoy. Worst mistake in the world. We won't gain anything in an attempt to blacken the Gregg name. People don't want that. We've agreed with Mrs. Gregg to call no female witnesses. Now, I'm sure I don't have to tell you we've exacted every consideration from the family in exchange. Her anxiety to protect the family is one of the things most in our favor. Doctor? All the law don't go on in the courts, McAvoy. I'm sure I don't have to tell you that.
Mr. McAvoy.
Mr. McAvoy, you got to see to your affairs at home, sir. Your wife. Now, I don't want to have to get a court order, but those people are entitled to some consideration. They can detect her 4 houses down. Now, I hate to be so forward, but they're your neighbors, not to mention your Christian duty.
I'll tend to it.
Well, I know you had all this trouble.
What is your job, son?
I work for Mr. Giles. I don't know who was there for me.
For Mr. Giles?
Yes, sir. I do what he tells me. Otherwise, I get turned off.
And what are your duties?
I go for the mail when the train comes. I bring the freight bills.
I see. And you saw Robert McAvoy shoot Captain Gregg?
Yes, sir. Just like I done told it. I done been for the mail. I've been back about 20 minutes.
And when the shooting started, you just stood there. You didn't attempt to take cover.
There wasn't nobody shooting at me.
I see. Thank you.
Your Honor, I would like to examine the witness, if I may. Mr. Sims, did you also run errands for Captain Gregg?
Yes, sir. For him and Captain Giles both.
Did Captain Gregg ever give you any messages to take to any of the girls in the mill?
Yes, sir.
And what did those messages say?
I don't know.
You don't know?
No, sir.
Were the notes sealed?
No, sir.
But you never looked at them? Never even peeked at one of them?
No, sir. Wouldn't have done me no good to.
And why is that?
I can't read.
Yes.
I was wondering if I could talk to you for a minute.
Come in. Sit down. Mr. Jordan says your son won't hang. What do you want me to tell you?
I don't know. I can't be satisfied in my head. I got no friends to tell me right. Folks turn their head in the street. I know my boy done wrong, but he ain't like what they're trying to make him out. If they was to send him to the penitentiary, that'd be hard. But if they was to hang him, I don't believe I could live with that. My boy is no worse and no better than any other boy in this town, and I know he must have had some reason to do what he done if you just let him get up there and tell it himself.
That's not possible.
Why ain't it?
He's full of wild accusations. Slander. That won't help him now.
I can't tell what they're thinking.
Who?
Them people on the jury. I can't see nothing in their faces.
The jury commissioner draws the jury from the voter list. As you may know, I was calling on your son's case because of the high Negro population in this county. If you are asking me what I think it means to have them people sitting judgment on your son, I have to tell you, frankly, I don't know. But I doubt that it's a consideration.
If I just had some sign, I got to know something.
A lawyer's not a priest, nor a doctor. Laws are more vagrant than sickness or sin. A lawyer makes his case. He'd be a fool to speculate what a dozen other fools in a jury box might make of it.
Mr. Jordan said that all the law don't go on in the courtroom.
They say God sends no man a burden greater than he can bear.
Not much less, neither.
No man's lot so bad that he can't look at our neighbors who's not worse.
Where is he? Where is that neighbor? I'd like to see him.
Mr. Stedman, has the jury reached a verdict?
The jury has, Your Honor.
Robert McAvoy. Hold up thy hand. Thou wast heretofore indicted for that thou didst willfully, feloniously, and of thy malice aforethought kill and murder James J. Gray against the dignity and peace of the state of South Carolina. Now thou hast been found guilty of that murder by a jury of thy peers, and I do solemnly demand that thou show cause, if any thou hast, why execution of the judgment established by law for the state should not be passed upon thee. He saith nothing. It is considered by the court and pronounced as the judgment of the law that the said Robert McAvoy be taken to the place whence he last came, and there be kept in close and safe custody until Friday, the 30th day of June next. And on that said Friday, he be taken to the place of legal execution in this county, and there be hanged by his neck until his body be dead. May God have mercy on his soul.
I would have thought it would be your father would come.
Bobby wouldn't let him.
So he sent you?
No, ma'am. I wasn't sent. I come for my own self.
It's out of my hands. I can't do anything for you.
Yes, ma'am.
I always intended well toward your brother. I'm a Christian woman. But he has put to perdition all the hopes of this family.
Mrs. Gregg, I know what people said about James.
Yes. My people learned to live with slander a long time ago.
Mrs. Gregg.
No, I'm sorry. There was a family here. Community of people working together, joined in a common enterprise. My husband's, my family's bond to this community was of the spirit, not of the flesh.
Mrs. Gregg, I just wanted you to know that your son James never done nothing to me. I just come to say I was sorry. I know they ain't nothing I can do. And they can't nobody bring him back. But I just wanted to tell you that. And to say I was sorry. Somebody had to.
Miss McAvoy. Come here, please. Please, sit down. Wipe your face.
Yes, ma'am.
Daphne, we'll have some tea, please. My husband put a great deal of store in the people who work for him. A great deal of trust.
Yes, ma'am. I'll laundry this and bring it back.
I've tried to understand. It's so hard to know what God must mean by this. I look at you and I try to see some sign. Something in your face. These things must be set in motion at some point. Must have their beginning somewhere. I look at you and I see nothing. I see nothing in you of death, murder.
Did you want me to make the service, ma'am?
No, that'll be fine, Daphne.
Them lawyers wouldn't let him tell his part. They said it'd go better if he'd not testify.
We have to put ourselves in the hands of those who know best.
Yes, ma'am. I can't help but think it was just a mistake of some kind. If they'd have got me up there, I thought about it. I wonder what I would have said. I mean, if they asked me. I'd have maybe had to tell them about that gold piece. And it would have sounded worse than what it was. I mean, he never meant nothing by it. He done stuff like that, you know, just in fun.
Do what?
Well, you know, like offer you money. It didn't mean nothing. Bobby could not have known nothing about it. You know I wouldn't have told him, hot-headed as he was.
Oh, you are a little darling, aren't you?
I know I don't have no right to ask nothing of you. But Daddy just swore by Mr. Gregg, your husband.
My son was right about you people. I wouldn't listen to him. He used to make fun of my husband's idealism, and I wouldn't listen to it. I wouldn't hear it.
I wouldn't ask nothing for myself. Not for him even, Mrs. Gregg. Much as he loved his boys, I believe your husband would have wanted you to do something.
The poor and the downtrodden. He was so cynical.
I meant to ask nothing of ye. Before God.
Daphne, the young lady will be leaving now. Will you show her out?
Yes, ma'am.
I don't blame you, ma'am.
Please leave.
God bless you, ma'am.
Now, Mr. McAvoy, just turn slightly sideways here. Yes, that's right. No, look toward the camera. That's the way. We'll take a three-quarter view. Sit up straight now.
Will my leg show?
No, not at all. This will just be from about the waist up. I think that should do it now, Mr. McAvoy. Will you be wanting to see these? I mean, should I just have them sent directly to the family?
Yeah, sure, I don't need to see them.
Well, fine. I would like to ask you... Well, I'd like to ask if you had any objection to me making some copies.
What for?
Well, to have them. I thought maybe to print some, you know.
Sell?
Well, I thought perhaps your family might could use the money.
What do you think, Virgil?
Well, I don't know, Bob. Just whatever you think.
I would be willing to share anything realized on, say, a 50-50 basis.
Tell you what I think, Virgil. I think we better go.
Sure, Bob.
I don't give a big rat's ass if people are ignorant enough to buy them.
Don't you let my family know where the money come from. Virgil, you'll see to it for me, will you?
I sure will, Bob.
Morning, Lewis. Ah, go on then, you son of a bitch, if you don't know me.
Bobby.
They lied to me. Lied. Goddamn lied. I was never born to be hung. I knowed what he was. They didn't want to hear it. There was not so one would...
Bobby.
I'd have gone to the penitentiary.
He never done nothing, Bobby. He never...
I just can't stop thinking about it all. I just can't seem to quit thinking about it all the time. Like, you wake up some time of a morning, and for a minute you feel good, and then you see where you are.
I'd have told them anything, Bobby, I swear. They wouldn't let me. I'd have told them any kind of lie. I wouldn't... I'd have sworn I'd... ten Bibles, he would send my soul to hell forever and ever. I wouldn't care.
It's all right. Don't talk like that. It's all right. I want you to forget you ever had a brother. I want you to find the best man. You find the best man in the world. And you make him be good to you. And if you don't... And you have a good life, little sister, the best that anybody ever had in this damn world. Now go on home.
Tommy, you know he can't come in here.
I done told him. You tell him. Look at him.
Mr. McAvoy, you better just go on home now. You're not in no condition to help your son.
Y'all got to let me see my boy.
You're drunk.
I'm not.
You can't see him.
Why not?
You're drunk.
You better just go along now. Don't let your son see you like this.
I swear to God, I've not had a drink.
Tommy. Now, Tommy, if he won't go along peacefully, you'll just have to take him out of here. We can't have this in here. This is a sacred time.
Let's go.
No, wait a minute. Wait.
Wait a minute. Wait.
What are you looking at? You, by God, what are you looking at? Are you either? Have you got anything better to do? Huh? Have you got anything to say? Say it to me. Well, you got anything to say? Huh? Hell no, you ain't. Ain't any of you got a goddamn thing to say?
Would you gentlemen just come right this way, please? I've just moved right on up in there. That's right. Thanks.
Bob, did you want to say anything?
Hold it there, boy.